Hello, everybody. Welcome back to the Exponential Finance Podcast. Today, we welcome Matthew Chan, who's the Head of Public Policy, Regulatory Affairs, and Sustainable Finance at ASIFMA. Welcome, Matthew.
Hi, Norbert. Thanks for having me.
Thanks very much for joining and taking the time. Maybe first of all, for our listeners, we need to explain what ASIFMA is.
Sure. So ASIFMA stands for the Asian Security Industry and Financial Markets Association. So we're one of the largest trade associations across Asia Pacific. So we have about 125 members. Pretty much we represent the international firms, so predominantly investment banks, asset managers, as well as service providers. So that could be law firms, it could be infrastructure providers, data providers. We also have the Big Four consulting firms. And so really what we target is advocacy. So a lot of my work, for example, is advocacy around, you know, how do we tweak policy? How do we make sure policy is doing its job, but in an efficient way without unintended consequences? We also get involved in market development. So for example, on a geographical basis, looking at China, how China is opening up to international investment, India. We work with regulators there in terms of, you know, operationally, what does that look like? What can be improved from a regulatory perspective? What can be improved, etc. And we also get involved in standards and information sharing for our members. So, for example, in COVID-19, we played quite a significant role in terms of, on one hand, point of negotiation with different regulators and governments in the region, say in Singapore and Hong Kong, and the industry to negotiate what does working from home look like, what flexibilities needed to be afforded, etc. And then even information sharing amongst our membership in terms of, you know, what are best practices and so on. So quite a varied role. At times it's advocacy, sometimes it's a little bit of education, sometimes it's a little bit of think tank in terms of research, looking at issues and trying to get to the bottom of particular industry challenges.
Wonderful. And a few episodes ago, I spoke to Paul Rohrdy, who is a market structure expert in the US, and there's lots about the Robin Hood story and how you pay for order flow. But as part of that, we also discussed that the US market is pretty fragmented, right? With 13 exchanges, there's 50 execution venues, ATSs, etc. And a day or two later, ASIFMA, together with Oliver Wyman, you put out a report on market fragmentation in Asia. And I said, wow, this is fantastic. This is a great compliment. It's a 90-page report, and we'll put the link to the report in the description of the podcast for our listeners. What drove the writing of the report at this point? What was the trigger to come out with that right now?
Actually, it was never intended to be 90 pages. It was intended to be about 20 to 30 pages. But once you get started on a topic, it's such a big and complex area that we wanted to do it justice. We were talking before about post-crisis reform, and really a lot of the work that I do in public policy is dealing with post-crisis reform, some of the regulations that came through, and what some of the consequences of that regulation has been in terms of unintended consequences. And so because our membership tend to be international institutions working across multiple borders, they tend to feel regulatory driven market fragmentation perhaps more than other institutions. And so this has been an ongoing area of concern. And so there was really an opportunity for us to continue to raise these issues. Also structurally, there's been some developments. So some of the work that we've been doing, for example, is with the G20, IOSCO and the FSB, Financial Stability Board, the International Organization of Securities Commissions. And there has been an ongoing discussion about fragmentation for some time, but I think we haven't really solved all of the challenges that exist. And so what we wanted to do with the report was a couple of things. One was really continue the dialogue around market fragmentation. So continue to highlight instances that we see. And you'll see, or you'll know from the report, we cover legacy areas. So derivatives, trade reporting, benchmark reform from Europe. But we're also starting to look at emerging areas of fragmentation. So for example, one of the big priority areas for ASIFMA is sustainable finance. And yet we see a lot of variation in terms of policies and standards and frameworks in sustainable finance. Equally, we see another emerging area, which is data policy and data localization. And so again, this has an effect on markets where it stifles the ability for capital to move across borders. It makes it very difficult for institutions. But at the end of the day, it also affects end users. It affects market development and also affects financial sector stability as well. The other point that I want to make too is we wanted this to be an Asia-focused report. So while a lot of the conclusions and findings are actually intended to be international, what we did want to do is point out a couple of things. One is that fragmentation probably impacts a region like Asia-Pacific perhaps a little bit more than other regions. And then secondly, we wanted to make sure that readers were aware of some of the case studies and examples of fragmentation in this region. But getting back to the conclusion aspect of it, we wanted to provide a very holistic way of looking at fragmentation. So one, what are the drivers of fragmentation? Two, what are the examples? Three, what are the impacts in terms of end users, etc.? And then what is the remedy? So what is the remedy in terms of looking at fragmentation in a systematic way across the policymaking lifecycle?
I mean, in a certain way, fragmentation should be natural for a region that's as large and as diverse as Asia. So we'd always take an extra effort trying to harmonize rules across markets that are at different stages of development, that are at fundamentally different sizes, etc. So it's not an easy task at all trying to bring common structures to such a diverse infrastructure.
Even before we start to look at the region and the complexity of a region like Asia, it's almost like entropy. I think it's the second law of thermodynamics, where things generally move over time to a state of disarray. And really, it's almost like pushing water uphill because you're constantly trying to create order in an international system. And there are so many factors at play in terms of policymaking. And some of these factors might be global. Some of them might be international. There might be international standards set. But at the same time, every regulator is also thinking about national priorities, jurisdictional priorities. And so therefore, while on one hand, there might be some pushes towards let's standardize, let's think together, let's coordinate, let's share information, let's have memoranda of understanding. On the other hand, there's always going to be this kind of ebb and flow in terms of push-pull and therefore jurisdictions potentially going in different directions from one another. So that's one layer. And then the second layer, as you rightly note, is a region like Asia Pacific is so diverse. And that's one of the reasons I chose to be involved in Asia Pacific. One of the things I love about Asia is its complexity and dynamism, but also the broad swathe of levels of economic development. So on one hand, you've got very mature markets, financially speaking, Singapore, Hong Kong, Tokyo, the Australian market, if you include that in Asia Pacific. But then on the other hand, you've got emerging markets. And so economically, you've got a great level of diversity. You've got different attitudes towards policy and regulation. So we see that in data policy and privacy policy, for example. And I guess the other ingredient in terms of what sets Asia apart is the fact that unlike Europe, for example, there's no overall coordinating structures. Obviously, we have things like APEC and we have the ASEAN region, and there are some structures, but they're not as holistic and in-depth as you might say compared to the EU, for example. As a result, I think it's really important for us to talk about fragmentation in a region like Asia Pacific.
The 21st century is supposed to be Asia's century, and for that, certainly we need functioning capital markets. The report, I think, stated that until 2030, the Asian capital markets will grow at 3 times the speed of all the remaining markets, and by 2030 will be 50% of the global capital markets. And so that's a significant number.
That was also one of the reasons we chose to look at Asia Pacific. One, the fact that it is a complex region, but secondly, it's an important region. So if you think about global growth, global capital markets development, the big strides are going to be made in Asia Pacific. So whether that's markets like China, perhaps India, but also emerging Southeast Asia, it's really the market to be looking at, the region to be looking at. And as a result, if we don't get things like fragmentation sorted out, then that's going to be a real inhibitor. And also globally speaking, given the rise of Asia on the global stage.
Asians, there might be some preference to invest your money in your own region. Otherwise, you have underdeveloped markets and the only choice is to put your money into Apple, Facebook and Google. Maybe over time, that's not that attractive either. So a bit of cheering for the home team here as well.
We are seeing that. So traditionally, investment into the region came from places like the US into Asia. I think what we're seeing, well, a couple of factors. One is you're seeing rising wealth in Asia, whether that's in China, whether it's in other economies, emerging economies as well. So there is capital to be invested from Asia into Asia. That's one thing. And then on the other hand, there's a lot of economic growth and investment in economic infrastructure that's required. And so you've got both sides of the equation. You've got capital to be invested, but also opportunities for investment in Asia. And so again, that's another reason for us to be looking at fragmentation and solving some of the inefficiencies and difficulties that exist on a cross-border basis between markets in Asia Pacific.
So why do we have so much fragmentation then in Asia?
I mean, some of these factors are international, but we identified 4 drivers of fragmentation. One is a lack of standards. So the examples I would put forward around data policy and privacy protection requirements, just internationally, we're seeing a lack of standardization. The EU has GDPR, and then other jurisdictions have their version of GDPR, and there is actually quite a large range of manifestations of what that looks like. There's also significant differences in terms of whether you can move data across borders or not. Another example is operational resilience. Now, that's a key regulatory area that's moving ahead internationally. Some markets say the UK is moving very swiftly on that front. But then when you get to a region like Asia Pacific, there's different approaches to operational resilience. Whereas you could compare it to the UK, which is taking a very top-down view of operational resilience. And by that, I'm covering business continuity planning, cybersecurity risk, et cetera, et cetera. Whereas in Asian markets, we're seeing a lot of variation in how that plays out, trade reporting, et cetera. So that's lack of standards. There's also a tendency for extraterritorial policies. So for example, this actually comes from outside the region. So for example, the EU and the US having policies around derivatives regulation or reforms that impact activities in Asia Pacific. The EU benchmark reform, for example, has extraterritoriality components to that. So it makes it quite challenging for third-party benchmarks in Asia. Transactions where you're dealing with a EU regulated entity, if that involves an asset class that may depend on a Asian benchmark, for example, then in 22, you won't be able to rely on those benchmarks going forward. And so that's an example of extraterritoriality. Other drivers are localization and ring fencing. That plays out in terms of capital requirements at times and also in terms of resolution planning. We see that at times regulations that require local cooperation in Singapore or India, for example, for retail operations. So sometimes it's to do with activity, sometimes it's to do with geographical localization or ring fencing. And then the really big dynamic is inconsistent implementation. And so an example of that would be Basel. There were standards for Basel, and yet we saw internationally, and particularly differences between Asia and the rest of the world in terms of timing. So the rollout of Basel, for example, where you actually saw jurisdictions like Hong Kong stick to the official timetable, and yet at the same time, EU, US took a different approach in terms of timing. And so you have this divergence, and what that does is creates fragmentation. So different approaches, different standards in parts of Asia versus the US, for example. And so that impacts international firms. So there's some of the drivers of fragmentation globally, but certainly in Asia Pacific, we see instances of that.
Ring fencing is something that's really driven by national interest. If you need to create a banking entity, for example, in a certain jurisdiction to protect retail customers, then that traps capital, and the capital can't be allocated efficiently between different entities in different jurisdictions. That would be the argument that the international banks are making. The national regulator, of course, would say, I want the security for my people and I want my investors and savers' money protected, and we need to take all the measures that basically are part of our mandate. So there's an inherent conflict naturally.
Yeah, and I think this is almost that entropy point before. I think it comes down to, yes, different factors, different motivations. Another way to look at it, though, is systemic stability versus national stability. And so what we're seeing is this tension between a national jurisdiction trying to create stability, but at the expense potentially of the broader international system. And I think the remedy or the solution for that is more information sharing, perhaps coordination between national jurisdictions, perhaps a risk management approach, which is a little bit more flexible. Because what we do see is probably the fact that, you know, some of these examples are coming about from a lack of trust between regulators, between host and home regulators. And so if we have more coordination, more information sharing and more trust, I think there is opportunity for that tension to be dissected a little bit more and for a more effective and efficient way of dealing with some of these tensions.
Just as an example, how some of these rules even affect us in the fintech world, so a little further away from the traditional capital market security and derivatives markets, Goldman Sachs had to stop taking deposits in London with their UK version of Marcus, which is a retail offering, because they were getting closer to the 25 billion balance sheet mark. And if they hit this, then they need to ring fence their UK retail banking entity, which they obviously like to try to avoid. But the question then is also, are savers better served by not having that offering or having that offering capped at that 25 billion level, right?
Yeah, and I think you've struck upon one of the points that we make in the paper is not only is there a tension at times between international versus national priorities, but also between policy outcomes. So many regulators are looking at sometimes a narrow perspective, and that's part of their mandate. Securities regulators are looking at market integrity, they're looking at investor protection, but they may not be looking at competition or what are the best outcomes from a consumer perspective. And so the example that you put forward with Marcus and Goldman Sachs is, well, then what happened at the end of the day? At the end of the day, there was one less service offering in that particular market. That's a great example that we try and highlight in the report, is actually there might be unintended consequences. Sometimes it actually undermines the policy intent, but sometimes it has unintended consequences elsewhere. So for example, how does it affect end users? When we're looking at derivatives reform and regulation, for example, you know, if it's too difficult to offer an asset class in a particular market and a financial institution withdraws from that market, what does that mean? Does that mean that there are fewer, you know, one less hedging instrument to be used in that market? What's the repercussions of that? Does that mean that there's less ability to manage risk incrementally? So these things have a kind of flow-on effect. And so what we're trying to do with the report is say, look, this is not just about, you know, efficiency and complexity for financial institutions. It's actually about what is the impact that these things have on end users. Is there one less service offering? Is there one less tool in the toolkit for dealing with risk, for example? Does it mean that markets cannot develop, for example, in sustainable finance if we don't have common standards? And then what does it mean for financial stability? Again, both at the national level, but then at the systemic international level, if everyone's just pursuing things from one perspective as opposed to kind of thinking holistically.
Yeah, and to bring it back into the Asian context as well, the example quoted in the report was Korea, where you had the Korean won denominated interest rate swaps that need to be cleared at a central Korean counterparty. And because the market is not big enough, the overall the international market developed into an offshore model where you have non-deliverable products that are then traded and cleared in the LCH or in the US. And that can't be naturally in the interest of the Korean market either, but that's then again a consequence and the rightful question whether market participants are best served by taking these measures.
Yeah, exactly. So that's an example that we have. The implications of that are increased costs. So obviously it's more expensive when that demand's met offshore by CME, for example, or LCH. But yeah, as you say, that market is now being serviced in a way that's probably suboptimal. And then it calls into question, you know, what are the risks? So this is all about managing risk systemically, but what do we actually introduce with? And so that probably moves us in some ways to what we talk about in the report is about, well, thinking about these things through the policymaking lifecycle. So I've talked about obviously the need for standards at one end, coordination, and then we talk about how fragmentation can be looked at and thought about in the implementation stage. But we also look at post-implementation reviews. Is there an opportunity in that instance in Korea for us to look at the regulation? What is the impact? How can some of these consequences be looked at and reviewed? And then how can regulation and policy be adjusted to actually deal with some of the complexities that we're seeing? And then on top of that, what are the feedback mechanisms? So in an ongoing and sustainable way, this is probably the engineer in me talking, how do you continuously improve regulation? One, specific pieces of regulation. So looking at it through the implementation, looking at it post-implementation, and then feeding back information so it can be improved, but also in a more holistic way. What are the lessons that we can learn from certain jurisdictions and certain instances of policy being implemented? How can we take the learnings from that in a very structured and meaningful way and apply that to new areas of policy and reform? So, for example, all the things that we've learned from legacy instances of fragmentation, how can we apply what we've learned there to emerging areas like data policy and sustainable finance, for example?
So on the legacy side, given that many of these points came out of the global financial crisis and since like 10 years old regulation just about, for the most part, it's probably too late to influence changes there, or even it would be very costly to make modification to some of that going back what has already been implemented. So this is more about taking, as you said, the learnings from these things that happened over the last decade and make sure that as we're looking forward into sustainable finance, data localization, fincrime compliance, and operational resilience, which are the quoted upcoming emerging examples, take the learnings and apply them there so we're not making the same mistakes again?
Look, I actually think it's twofold. I think it is actually going back to some of the legacy areas of fragmentation and seeing what can be improved and what can be tweaked. certainly. But as you say, in addition to that, it's about looking at things that are emerging, policy that's emerging, and applying some of the learnings from legacy areas to these emerging areas. I'm still pretty young. I still got a lot of fight in me. And I think our members still think that there's value in looking at legacy issues and how regulation can be improved over time. And to be fair to the standard setting bodies like FSB, IOSCO, there are structures in place increasingly to look at fragmentation. And that's another trigger for us writing in the report, is for them to actually think about Asia Pacific. The G20 presidency under Japan has also been quite favourable in making sure that while we have not solved fragmentation issues, what we have done is create structures and forums for it to be discussed. Even, for example, the IOSCO has an affiliate members consultative committee, and the IOSCO board will be hearing from the AMCC on fragmentation issues. So one of the things I'm doing with other trade associations, not just in Asia, but actually globally, is actually preparing a report on market fragmentation, because it is an area that is quite challenging, but it hits both these legacy areas. I still think there's opportunity for improvement, but certainly there's also indications of it evolving and manifesting in emerging areas of regulation. Obviously, the treatment and the remedies are going to be different. So I think if you think about legacy areas, it's going to be much more about post-implementation review, consultation between regulators, policymakers, perhaps supervisory colleges and standard-setting bodies about what's working, what's not, and how can things be improved, perhaps in a more incremental way. Whereas when we're looking at emerging areas like operational resilience or data or sustainable finance, then we do have an opportunity to look at the overall standards. Is there or is there not an opportunity for globally coordinated approach to, say, operational resilience or to taxonomies for sustainable finance? And so we probably do have the luxury for some of these newly emerging areas for us to think much earlier on in the policymaking life cycle. But as I said, I do think there's opportunity to look at legacy areas, because the other point that the report makes is one of the biggest drivers, in fact, of fragmentation is in the implementation. So on one hand, you might have standards, but actually it's the implementation. Sometimes that's to do with timelines and timing. That can be resolved over time. There can be better coordination on that. Sometimes it's to do with more information sharing, deference tools, for example, recognizing derivatives reforms and regulation in one jurisdiction, in a home jurisdiction, for example. And so there's opportunities to work with what we have and address fragmentation.
You're a little bit more optimistic than I am, is simply seeing a regulation as an ever-growing bureaucracy versus just being added to, but hardly ever anything taken away. And maybe I've been burned a few too many times during my career there.
Speak to me in a few years and maybe I'll be a little bit more chastened.
True for especially the role that you have. You can't wake up and say, I can't change anything, right? And that wouldn't be the right role. It would go insane. You clearly need to have a positive outlook. If you take an example, if you take the area of fincrime compliance, would you say that what the Financial Action Task Force is doing in terms of KYC, AML, and CTF, that these are the types of things that will help to have a more harmonized approach?
Yeah, I think there is certainly opportunity in financial crime compliance. So one of the things that we talk about in the report is just differences in standards. For example, even definitions. So I think a couple of the examples that we have in the report are, what is a politically exposed person, for example? That might differ between different jurisdictions. What is the threshold for defining ultimate benefit ownership? So we might actually see common phrases or phraseology in policy internationally, which is a great thing, but actually the definitions differ. So that speaks to the opportunity for more information sharing, more coordination, so that actually, why don't we just make it so that we're talking about the same things in the same circumstances? And so I do think that there's opportunity still for greater standardization.
So how do you view the implementation of the legal entity identifier, LEI, so far? How is it viewed by your members? Has it been a success and is it helpful?
I actually worked for DTCC previously and we were an LEI issuer. It is true that there has been some differences in terms of take up of LEIs. I think probably in a region like Asia Pacific, there's been less progress on adopting that. There's also been different requirements, even between different jurisdictions in Asia, in terms of what does it mean if you're dealing with an entity that does not have an LEI or an LEI that's expired. So there are certainly challenges in terms of differences in take up of LEI. And so that's probably an opportunity for improvement. But there's also opportunity in terms of how do you deal with that variation. So there's also room for improvement in terms of a more standardized approach to the use of LEIs and how that's regulated.
The one thing that the report doesn't go into, because it probably would have added another 100 pages to it as well, is the whole area of digital assets and new exchanges that are being built, in particular across the Asia region. It feels like we have quite a number of virtual currency, digital asset, security token exchanges coming up. Is that an opportunity or a threat from your members' perspective?
I mean, obviously the markets continue to evolve, and even on the fragmentation front, that's an example of divergence. For example, Singapore and Korea, for example, are quite welcoming of virtual assets, and yet you see China and India being less so. So that's an area where we see divergence. I think it is an area of opportunity. I personally think that there's always opportunity for innovation, and I think that should be celebrated. But at the same time, I also recognize that from a policymaking perspective, you also need to think about AML, you need to think about financial crime, etc. And so what needs to happen from a regulatory perspective is just greater clarity and greater consistency in terms of how these things are dealt with. Because again, even on the AML CFT front, with respect to virtual currencies, we often see differences in points of view and policymaking. To some extent, that happens because, you know, this is a nascent area and some markets will be moving faster than others. But at the same time, I think there's opportunity, I guess, international information sharing coordination to make sure that as these developments do occur, there's actually a coordinated view in terms of understanding what the risks are and how they should be dealt with.
Okay, wonderful. I mean, in terms of the detail of the report, there's nothing that replaces actually reading it. So again, we're going to post the link in the podcast description. And it is super content rich. So for anybody who wants to get a good view on the issues driving Asian securities and derivatives markets, it's certainly a recommended read. To round it out, given that you're based in Hong Kong is the gateway to China. With all the activities in the US, where we're seeing delistings of Chinese companies and maybe the moves back into the home market, with Hong Kong still the primary exchange. Also upcoming, the Ant Financial IPO at $200 billion valuation or so. So it is an interesting time for further opening up the Chinese capital market, make it more fungible, and exciting time to be there from a development perspective, I would think. What's your perspective a few years out on Hong Kong in the context of the Greater Bay Area? How's this going to shape up?
Many institutions are in Hong Kong, in part because at the end of the day, Hong Kong is a world-class financial center. But secondly, as you say, it's a gateway to China. A lot of the work that ASIFMA does is around market development and certainly dialogue with regulators in China. And I have to say, we've been through COVID and there's lots happening in the world at the moment. But the conversations that we're having with regulators and policymakers are still moving in the same direction and, if anything, have accelerated. So we have seen and heard from, whether it's PBOC or CSRC or CBIRC, very much a commitment to continuing to open up the Chinese markets. We've also seen commitment and action in terms of leveling the playing field. So one of the things that we look at from a market perspective on behalf of our members is, you know, level playing field issues, ownership structures, requirements, etc., that have in the past made it difficult for international firms to participate and bring investment flows into China. We're actually seeing piece by piece those inhibitors being dealt with. And so that's actually still moving in a very positive direction. It's not slowing down. So I would say, looking in a few years' time, I would still see Hong Kong being a key financial market, still being a key gateway into China. There's also issues around, you know, there's things that Hong Kong affords that other markets can't in terms of how data is managed in Hong Kong versus having to be in China, for example. What we're seeing is commitment from the local authorities to obviously enhance the competitiveness of Hong Kong, to continue Hong Kong's role in terms of playing as a gateway to China. And then even with GBA. So for example, I was having a conversation the other day with someone about, you know, what are the priorities for Hong Kong? It's part around wealth management, so making it more attractive to family offices, also sustainable finance. So that's a real push around ESG. I think everyone here in Hong Kong is thinking about, we're coming off the back of COVID-19. There's a lot of market disruption globally. There's a lot of, I guess, jockeying between different financial centers. And look, I think Hong Kong, the government here is very focused on making sure that Hong Kong remains competitive. And so I'm quite optimistic about that being the case.
looking back my history with Goldman Sachs, we got the approval to have a broker dealer in China under our management control in 2004, which was really the first foreign entity to get that approval. We opened the broker dealer in 2005. And at that time in Beijing, we had designated this financial center area. We were one of the first buildings in this whole area. Everything else was very empty. And unfortunately, I think I've been back once since then over the last 15 years, but I've seen photos of how different that whole area looks, and it's certainly a sign of the growth, and also the industry has matured, so it will be super interesting to see how this is further developing, and especially with the Ant Financial IPO. I wanted to hook once more into the sustainable finance, because it's also part of your remit. When we look at your job description, public policy, regulatory affairs, yep, clearly fit together. And then plus sustainable finance, is that something that you grabbed out of personal interest, or is it something that is seen really as part of a broad policy agenda, and that's why it's in your portfolio?
That's a really interesting question. The short answer is it closes a number of circles. Personally, I'm passionate about sustainable finance. I wasn't always in financial services. My first degree was in engineering, and I actually specialized in environmental engineering. So I've always had this kind of engineering component to my career. I moved away from environmental engineering quite early on, but it's always resonated and echoed throughout my career. As it happened, ASIFMA, even before I joined the trade association, was looking at green finance, and that's been an ongoing theme in Asia Pacific for some time. On top of that, we've seen the growth of ESG, and probably towards the middle of last year, or even before, sustainable finance just grew to be quite a priority for our members. We've seen a lot of policy making and standard setting coming out of Europe. We're seeing that this is a global phenomenon, both in terms of how that plays out in Asia. So there's actually a real opportunity for us in Asia to actually have a voice in some of that policy making and standard setting. We've also seen demand for ESG investment growing, particularly around pension funds and sovereign wealth funds, but also retail. But we also see many opportunities in emerging Southeast Asia, for example, where there's an opportunity for securing funding through green financing, for example. So there's all these kinds of things that are at play. Why is it sitting in public policy? I guess it kind of goes back to what I was talking about before in terms of the policy life cycle. There's an opportunity for us to think about how do we develop sustainable finance, scale it. And one of the key factors is the regulatory and policy making settings. How do we make sure that standards are consistent internationally, but also how do we make sure that policy making is done in a standard kind of way? And so because this is very early on, I think there's a great opportunity, and our members see great opportunity in making sure that we get the rail gauges right so that we can scale this up. And so that, for example, you know, if you have the right taxonomy, you have standard ways of defining what's green, what's brown, what's transitional, you have standard approaches to disclosure requirements, then that affords greater comparability between different industries, between different jurisdictions. Because at the end of the day, investment flows move across borders and need to move across borders. And so the more standardization you have, the greater ability for capital to move across borders. But also at the end of the day, you know, the issues that we're dealing with tend to be very international, environment, social, perhaps governance to some extent, but really the E and the S are dynamics that move across borders. And so there's a real opportunity for us to think internationally about this. And so that fits into my wheelhouse from a public policy perspective. In addition to that, we're looking at market development. So when it comes to scaling up sustainable finance, what are the market structures that are needed? One of my projects is actually look at data requirements and data challenges that exist in Asia to support ESG. Because if we don't have standardized data, or data is too unstructured, or it's not comparable, then we're really going to be struggling to support the ESG and sustainable finance sector. Yeah, lots of opportunity. And then, as we mentioned before, as international financial centres like Hong Kong and Singapore are thinking about, you know, what's going to make them competitive, we're finding increasingly that we're talking about ESG and we're talking about sustainable finance. So there's all these things coming around full circle. Yeah, I'm quite pleased to be able to be part of that.
Super. Personal circle that's closing with your early days. That's quite nice as well. Wonderful. Thank you very much, Matthew. There's so much more to cover, but we hopefully did the 90-page report justice in highlighting the things that we did, and our listeners found it enjoyable. So we have a super interesting role. Good luck going forward. And I hope that after the pandemic, we'll find an opportunity to meet in person as well.
Absolutely. Thanks, Norbert. I really appreciate this opportunity. It's great to talk to you. Thank you.